Hey guys, in today's video we're talking about versatile video coding, or H.266, AV1, MPEG-5 EVC, and how codecs are shaping up in the high-resolution modern era that is 2020. Now, before we get into versatile video coding, I think it's probably worthwhile to just quickly run through codecs and what they are. A codec is a method of encoding and decoding a specific type of file, and in this case, we're of course talking about a video file. The encoding process involves a lot of tasks, but mainly the idea here is to make the file size smaller by using compression techniques. So in other words, it's compressing the video. Now, once that video file has been transferred over the internet or maybe even stored on portable storage media, it must be decoded by the device or software that is responsible for playing or viewing it. This too is a part of the codec. Now, it's important to point out that codecs and video coding formats are not the same thing, though for many and most people, the difference isn't meaningful. That is a discussion for another video altogether, so we'll just leave it at that. HEVC or H.265 hit the scene in 2013 with the ability to take a video file and half its size from the previous benchmark codec that was H.264 AVC. This was all done without a loss in quality. In real world numbers, all this meant was that a 4K video using H.264 would require about 32 megabits of bandwidth. HEVC shrunk that same video down to about 15 megabits per second. HEVC is now 7 years old. QNH.266 Versatile Video Coding, or VVC. This is a codec that has been developed by the Fraunhofer Heinrich Hertz Institute, which is the same group that created the popular MP3 audio format, H.264, and the H.265 codecs we all know and love today. VVC promises to reduce the bandwidth required for a video by a further 50% over its predecessor codec, HEVC. And honestly, in a nutshell, that's about as far as you want to go in terms of technicalities, because codecs can be very, very complex and involve complex mathematical algorithms. The simplest way in which all of this works is that in any given video, there are parts of the frame that never move, or let's say change from one frame to the other. These codecs work by simply freezing those frames in a sense, allowing for huge savings in bandwidth. And if that still doesn't make sense, then think of it like this. This video is shot in my living room. Everything around me is stationary, apart from myself. So in theory, the codec could quite literally draw a mask around my silhouette and focus on information in that area frame to frame, because that's the only thing that's changing. Now, of course, in this particular case, the Chromecast on my television keeps changing the wallpaper every couple of minutes, so it has to account for that too. But in essence, that's the theory behind how these codecs work. And as mentioned before, in reality, there's so much more to it than just that, including complex mathematical algorithms and a whole lot of complicated stuff that no one wants to think about. In a nutshell, a 4K video that requires 6 GB of data in HEVC will now require 3 GB with VVC whilst maintaining the same quality as before. The Fraunhofer Heinrich Hertz Institute has actually developed this codec in partnership with many big electronics companies like Apple, Microsoft, Sony, Intel, Qualcomm, Huawei, and Ericsson. So a lot definitely goes into the research and development of this stuff. It's not just for the sake of new discoveries, it's work that's done over long periods of time with a lot of experimentation. Now let's talk about AV1. This is a codec developed by the Alliance for Open Media, or AOM, which is a non-profit organization with members like Amazon, Apple, Google, Facebook, Samsung, and even Netflix. AV1 is not quite as impressive as VVC in terms of compression, though it's still pretty decent, promising savings between 30 to 40% in bandwidth over HEVC. So the major question becomes, what's the point of AV1 if we are already getting VVC, which we already know is more efficient, right? Well, it all comes down to the fact that AV1 is completely royalty-free, so anybody can use it free of charge without ever having to pay a penny. VVC requires a paid license, and while you might think that the license is no big deal for big companies, just pay it, think of it on a mass scale. With everything basically moving to streaming platforms from television to movies and television shows, you can easily see how AV1 might end up being the codec of choice for many streaming networks. And I guess it really comes as no surprise the fact that the companies partnering up in the Alliance for Open Media that are pushing for this codec are companies like Apple, Amazon, Google, and Netflix, who would all benefit from this codec as they are major key players in the media streaming industry. And with media resolution forever on the rise, eyes, you can easily see why such developments would definitely be well worth your while going into the future. As a matter of fact, Netflix has already started using AV1 on some videos when streaming onto Android devices. So that's already a pointer that AV1 is the next big thing. Now let's talk about MPEG-5, developed by the Moving Pictures Expert Group, from which the acronym MPEG is derived. This is the same organization that created the MPEG-2 standard that is pretty much used for all television broadcasts in North America and Japan. They have now developed what they are calling MPEG-5 Essential Video Coding, or EVC. Similar to VVC and AV1, MPEG-5 promises up to 25% less bandwidth in comparison to HEVC. It's already been approved by Huawei, Qualcomm, and Samsung, and as a matter of fact, these companies have committed to the licensing terms, aiming to announce this in the next 2 years. MPEG-5 works in a different way to the other two codecs in the sense that it applies new coding techniques to older codecs like HEVC, AV1, and AVC, as opposed to creating a new video coding system from scratch. This is the one that I believe is likely to get the lowest adoption as time goes by, simply because it's the master of none. It's not any better than any of the other two codecs and offers no benefits over the others. So those are our new video codecs for 2020, and in my opinion, this is perfect timing, I believe. With 8K resolution becoming more and more mainstream, you can see how these new codecs are going to become vital. When the Canon R5 was announced, I made a video, and one of the major concerns I had was just the sheer bandwidth required for 8K video, and we're talking on a mainstream consumer level. This is a mirrorless camera that any one of us can simply just walk into the store and buy. The file sizes and data rates are absolutely ridiculous, and this is where these codecs fit in. H.266, AV1, and MPEG-5 give us a very sound and solid platform moving into the future of streaming and high-resolution media consumption. Now, I highly doubt we'll be seeing 8K streaming on a mainstream level on platforms like Netflix, Amazon Prime Video, or even Apple TV anytime soon, but 4K is definitely already halfway there, with plenty of content on those said platforms already being delivered in 4K. These codecs are very much welcome, as they will further improve streaming efficiency right now with 4K, but also future-proof the idea of maybe eventually shifting to streaming 6K or 8K or even higher resolutions on a mainstream level. Who knows? In today's climate, H.264 AVC still has a large chunk of the video codec market, and it is a 17-year-old creation. Statista estimates that H.264 takes up about 82% of the market share of top online video codecs and containers worldwide from the year 2016 to 2018, with HEVC only taking up 12% during that same period. It's believed that the sluggish adoption of HEVC throughout the last 7 years has been due to the various issues with licensing terms that have plagued the codec. H.266 is definitely a jump in the right direction in terms of technology, but it is already feared that it may in the end suffer the same fate as HEVC, since it will be available on a similar licensing model. The Fraunhofer Heinrich Hertz Institute promises a transparent licensing model where there will be fairness, reasoning, and no discrimination, but I guess only time will tell. I personally believe that the one to look out for is AV1. Though not as efficient as VVC, the fact that it's royalty-free will make it a no-brainer for streaming networks, or at least be high up on their list of considerations. All in all, at the end of the day, it's we the consumers that will benefit from lower streaming bandwidth, meaning less data on your mobile data plan, and even less storage required for your videos on devices like your mobile phone and computer. Thanks for watching, guys, and hope that this video has been useful to you. Please drop a like or a comment if you enjoyed it, and if you didn't, then make sure to hit that dislike button twice. If you're new to the channel, make sure you're subscribed and hit that bell icon to get notified when I upload new videos. Catch you folks in the next one.